morning. We're going to go on and get started. This morning. It's Monday, April 10th, and I'm Mindy Tate, CEO of Franklin Tomorrow. Welcome to our monthly FrankTalks lecture. This one's City Hall on Wheels, and so we're excited you're here today at Columbia State. Thanks for the hospitality, Dr. Lampley, Daryl Lampley, and Mary Beth Challey. And we just really appreciate the hospitality here at Columbia State and the early morning hill climb, right? I mean, you got to climb that hill to get here. So it's a good workout for us all. And I just have to stop eating chocolate now. The Easter Bunny has come and gone, and I cannot eat any additional chocolate this week. Please put me on that list of people. I'll just substitute caffeine. But thanks so much. FrankTalks is presented monthly by our good friends. Renaissance Bank is our presenting partner, and then supported by our sustaining partners, Atmos Energy and Williamson Health. So we appreciate the support of Atmos, which provides safe, reliable, and efficient natural gas to Tennessee. And last year at one of our Breakfast with the Mayors, we heard a lot about the expansion of broadband into our community. And maybe we'll hear sometime this year about the infrastructure in our community, not maybe necessarily from the city side, but those private utilities who are semi-public that are putting out the power in our area, whether that's gas or electricity and the grid. And so we'll probably have a program on that soon as well. So thanks to Atmos for their support as a sustaining partner. And Williamson Health, Greg Brory is here. Greg, come on up, and Emily will punch the button in a minute.
Good morning. Good morning. On behalf of the 2,000 employees of Williamson Health, we are glad to be with you today. Williamson Health brings more for you close to home, with more than 30 locations across Williamson County, including our flagship hospital, Williamson Medical Center, physician and specialty clinics, and emergency medical technicians using the latest life-saving equipment, including the Lucas 3 system. Let's take a look at how this is helping.
Lucas is an automated CPR device that we carry on every ambulance here in Williamson County. It's kind of like in a backpack, so it's very mobile. When we go on a patient that is having a cardiac arrest where chest compressions need to be done, it allows us to continuously do chest compressions throughout the duration of us working that cardiac arrest. With this device, it stays attached to the patient and can be continuously doing those compressions while we're moving that patient from point A to point B. Take this in on calls that we were dispatched for actual cardiac arrest, patient's not breathing, patient doesn't have a heartbeat, something where it's reported where CPR is being done. Really an extra set of hands. So we may be securing an advanced airway, we may be pushing medications to help try to restart that heart, defibrillating the patient, a lot of other interventions that it frees us up to do now that we don't have a person dedicated just to doing the chest compressions. That is offering a better outcome for that patient because we have zero interruptions in chest compressions. I definitely do think this is a game changer. According to our protocols, anybody above age 12 and higher, we can apply this device to. We don't apply this device to patients that are of traumatic arrest nature. We have some limitations on circumference size of patients. So as long as our actual device can fit around the circumference of the patient, it can be used. It makes me feel great that we carry Lucas on every ambulance here in Williamson County. I do believe this will save lives.
Wow, that's impressive, and it makes you feel a little better knowing that they're carrying those on the ambulances that respond here in our county. So we appreciate the support of Williamson Health. Our folks at Renaissance Bank, just wave and say hi. Tony, Tina, Clinton, hey, everybody, hey. Normally, that's about it. And drive-through teller far away, right? Yes, and so it's all good. If y'all at that remote drive-through thing, that's really kind of cool, but you can't go in and say, oops, I made a mistake. So that's a problem. So good stuff. Thank you to coffee sponsor, Lion Leadership Group, who's the local McDonald's franchisee and owner, and we appreciate their support here at Frank Talks and at Breakfast with the Mayors. Okay, I'm going to do something I don't ever do. I think we're going live this morning on our social media, thanks to the City of Franklin. So if you want to share it on your Facebook page, go to the City of Franklin and share it. Share that link to your Facebook page so other friends and neighbors can do that. You can find all of our videos on our, most often on our social media, but also on our YouTube channel. If you type in youtube.com and go and type in Franklin Tomorrow, you'll pull up our videos, and we try to put them on playlists, and that way you can share them with friends or go back and learn more about a subject or item that you might be interested in. So thank you. So Frank Talks, again, monthly, second Monday of the month, unless it's like spring break like it was last month and we decided to wait. But second Monday of the month, various locations across the community. We've been doing City Hall on Wheels for several years, and it's kind of fun because we stole this idea from our friends in Mount Pleasant, South Carolina, but we made it better. You know, they just went and had coffee somewhere with whoever showed up. We try to put a point and share some information with you. And so we're going to turn it over now to Eric Stuckey and Michael Walters Young. And you're going to introduce your special, you have a special guest. I'll let you introduce that one over there.
Yes, we have the mayor of Franklin with us, Dr. Ken Moore. So you got to recognize our esteemed leader. And thanks for joining us today. Before I jump into this, I want to make sure you have on your calendar the opportunity to participate further in our Envision Franklin process, which is the update of our land use plan. We have right now an ongoing survey that's online. You go to franklintn.gov, you can take that survey, another way to have your voice heard. And then there is a special session this Thursday evening at 6 o'clock. It'll be a virtual platform, so it'll be a Zoom meeting for the community about housing needs and how it relates to our land use plan. We're going to hear a little more about housing needs and concerns and what we're going to talk about in the citizen survey coming up. So that's obviously something that's on people's minds. It's an important element of the updated land use plan. So if you want to plug into that, you can. You can do it virtually, so you can be cooking dinner and be at a city meeting at the same time. And it's 6 o'clock on Thursday. Just go to franklintn.gov. You'll get the information, the link. It's great to have you register for that ahead of time as well. So check that out. Okay. Many times when we've had Frank Talks and City Hall on Wheels, we've had Nancy Conway here to ask us a trivia question. Well, unfortunately, we don't have Nancy with us today. She's healing up, which is great. But I'm going to ask you a trivia question. What is the breakfast of champions? What is it? Give it to me. Wheaties. That's right. That's the advertising campaign. You know what else is the breakfast of champions? Feedback. Feedback. It is getting feedback from your customers, from your partners, from your community is the breakfast of champions. It makes you stronger. It helps you understand your community. So that's an axiom someone shared with me years and years ago that has stuck with me, that feedback is actually the breakfast of champions. So that's what we're talking about today, is our breakfast of champions, which is feedback from our citizens. And so since 2012, we've done four different citizen surveys. And my hat is off to Franklin Tomorrow, who was our partner in the very first one in 2012 that really got the ball rolling. They helped us secure some funding that helped that first survey get off the ground. And since then, we have used that survey and our partners at the Williamson County Realtors Association.
The pollster on that out of D.C. used to refer to it as this Goldilocks survey.
Yes.
Everything was good. Everything's good.
Everything
good.
Was just right, I think was the term he used. But we wouldn't say, he said that, we didn't say that. We are always trying to get better and work on that. And that's part of why we reach out to our citizens and say, how are we doing? And we say it in about 70 different ways, but we're really saying, how are we doing? As a community, as a city government, as a service provider, and overall, how do people feel about what is going on? What are their perceptions of what's happening in the community? So we're going to talk to you about what our latest survey that was completed at the end of last year, the end of 2022, shares with us. And I'm going to have Michael Walters Young, who has led that effort, Is this the third or fourth one, the third one that you've done, right? And so Michael has really helped shepherd that through the last three times and has a great grasp of what we're getting in our feedback and the context and how it hits both what we've heard in previous surveys, how it compares to national benchmarks, and just what are trends and things that we're seeing that relate to some of the work we're doing at the city. So Michael's going to lead that through. Michael's day job, when he's not doing community surveys and lots of other things, he works as our budget and strategic initiatives manager at the city. And Michael's been with us nine years in June. So does a great job. If you've ever seen a budget presentation from Michael, he can really bring those points together, technical, in-depth information in a way that's understandable to everyone. And that is a gift. And you'll see that on display as Michael walks you through the survey results. I will chime in from time to time, but Michael really will lead you through it. And then we'll be glad to talk a little further as we go. And I think we have a follow-up session next week to touch on this in more depth that many will fill you in on as well. So Michael, take it away.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. So, this is about 28 slides. There's lots of information. We're going to take you through it in an expeditious manner, but a thorough manner. We'll talk about the survey methodology. We'll talk about our results. And then really what we find most useful is certainly our comparables. How do we compare to ourselves in previous surveys, 2012, 2016, and 2019? How do we compare on our strategic plan, Franklin Forward, in terms of those benchmarks? And then how do we compare with the Joneses, if you will? How do we compare nationally to other cities and counties that utilize this survey tool, as well as to cities and towns of our approximate size, which is 50 to 100,000? So, and then, of course, next steps. So this survey was conducted in two ways. A scientifically valid survey of randomly selected residents, roughly 2,800, and then an open web-based survey. If you got chosen, you would have received a postcard in the mail. We had about 100 of those returned. So the total survey size that we sent out were 2,800. The total amount we got back in returns was about 100. So the survey pool itself was 2,700 total surveys. These were sent out in three mailings, 1 week apart, beginning in late October. The first mailing was a postcard notifying you of the survey. The second was a letter signed by the mayor and Eric inviting you to participate. And then the third was a final reminder letter with another survey attached. And you had the opportunity to complete the survey either in writing and then mail it back in, postage paid, of course, or you could simply use the link that was unique to you and enter it online. There were 8 weeks then from October 24th until early December in which survey respondents could respond to the survey. As I said, 4% were returned. Of those that received it, 448 actually completed the survey. That is a response rate of 17%. It is important to note that that is the lowest we've had in doing these three surveys. We had a response rate of 37% in 2016 and 29% in 2019. The national average is a little below where we were in 2019, which is 26%. So that is the sort of proof survey, if you will. All of the results, which you will see in the ensuing slides, tie back to that information, which the survey company, Polco, and the National Research Center were able to validate and count. You also had the option, we had this online and available to anyone, and 217 surveys were taken by individuals, some of you may be in this room, who had the chance to go ahead and participate and submit your results, but those were not counted in sort of the official proof of those 2,700 total. So this is called the National Community Survey. It is a tool that's been out for several decades, used by the particular vendor that we use, and it's designed to measure our livability. That is defined as the sum of factors that add up to an overall community's quality of life. Staff at Polco and NRC has done extensive research regarding community livability and developed 10 central facets of what makes up the livability in a community. And you see those now on the screen. Economy, mobility, community design, utilities, safety, natural environment, parks and recreation, health and wellness, education, arts and culture, and inclusivity and engagement. And we have survey results for each of these 10 areas. So key takeaways. The first is that residents truly appreciate many aspects of city leadership and governance. 8 out of 10 rated customer service and quality of city services as positive. That would be defined as responding. There were basically 4 ways you could answer most questions. Excellent, good, fair, or poor. So most of these responses and most of the data you're going to see presented today is a degree of positive. So that is excellent or good. 7 out of 10 said that they get a good value for the taxes that they pay. 2 out of every 3 believe that the government is acting in the best interests of the people. And that's comparable numbers to other surveys. Many aspects of Franklin's community design, aka how it's planned and how it's developed, receive positive reviews. But certainly there are areas of opportunity. People really like living in Franklin, Tennessee, and they like the overall layout. But there are strong concerns, and you'll see this as we go along, as Eric already foreshadowed, regarding affordable housing, workforce housing, and the ability to, quite honestly, stay within your homes. Franklin's economy is strong, but certainly there are challenges to community livability. And this we'll show in a minute, really regarding the local economy. There are significant concerns in the short term about where the economy is going, but access to jobs, access to shopping, access to employment opportunities are among the top nationally out of any response. And finally, Franklin's educational, cultural opportunities are a very valued aspect of overall livability. We have very high rankings when it comes to image, access to events and celebrations, and rating of overall quality of life.
So as Michael goes into this, sorry, it's so loud. these are things we're pulling out, but these are the findings that the polling company highlighted in looking at Franklin and looking at the universe of other communities that do this same survey. So this is us pulling elements out, but it's really the staff from the polling company that's highlighting these key findings. So this isn't just us sharing it with you, it's what they gleaned from it in comparison to other communities and what they felt really stood out in the different categories.
And of course, what we should have led off with is all of this information is available at franklintn.gov. We have a tab under Finance and Administration labeled the National Citizen Survey. And you can see and have access to the full report and to the full open-ended questions, which I will get to in a little while, for all 3 of our surveys, 2022, 2019, and 2016. So there are 2 sort of overall anchors that I want to talk about before we get back to those 10 facets of community livability. The first is ranking overall quality of life. Almost all residents and respondents to their survey rated quality of life in Franklin, Tennessee as positive. 97% rated it as excellent or good. And you can see there on the screen that 60% rated it as excellent, and 37% rated it as good, 3% as fair, and no one rated the quality of life in Franklin, Tennessee as poor. This is consistent, remarkably so, and remarkably positive, in the 2016, the 2019, and the 2022 surveys. They've all been at 97%. It is much higher than the quality of life seen in other cities, and it puts us actually 7th in the nation for overall quality of life, given the 600 survey respondents in cities and counties that utilize this tool. Governance. 68% rated Franklin's, their confidence in Franklin government as positive. So that would be 48% good and 20% excellent. This is down from 2019, where this ranking was 75% positive. It is higher than national benchmarks. We also rank higher in national benchmarks for overall customer service provided by city employees, 89% positive. That's something that we take particular pride in, of course, for our fellow coworkers. The value of services for the taxes paid, the job Franklin government does at welcoming resident involvement, and generally acting in the best interest of the community. It is important to note that on all of these metrics, the percentage responses of positive are slightly lower than they were in 2019. So the first survey facet to focus on is the economy. The overall perception of strength is that Franklin's economy remains very strong. However, you see that second chart on the screen to the right. What impact, if any, do you think the economy will have on your family income over the next 6 months? And do you think it will be very positive, somewhat positive, neutral, somewhat negative, or very negative? 80% of survey responses had either neutral or negative. So it's very clear that the current state of the economy and the uncertainty, whether that be with inflation, whether that be general affairs, what have you, was weighing on respondents' minds. I don't think that comes as a great shock to anyone sitting in the room. That being said, we still rank very, very well. We rank fifth nationally in terms of a place to work. We rank highly as a place to visit. We rank fifth nationally in terms of the variety of business and service establishments, so the choice that you have to be able to go shop and eat and work. And then second nationally, when it comes to employment opportunities and the vibrancy of our downtown. People really like working here. People really like shopping here. And people really like the downtown. Second survey facet of livability is mobility. Over two-thirds respondents rated the overall quality of the transportation system in Franklin as excellent or good, 69%. Ratings on mobility, with the exception of the ease of travel by bicycle and public transportation usage, were similar to other cities. And we'll get to that a little later on as well. That's been consistent in the 2016 and 2019 surveys and also does not come as a great shock. It's important to note that the city's provision of street cleaning and sidewalk maintenance were noted as higher than the national benchmarks, something our streets department was very happy to hear. In terms of community design, nearly three-fourths or 74% respondents rated the overall design or layout of residential and commercial areas as positive. This is slightly down from 2019, where it was at 80%. Respondents still rate their neighborhood as a place to live much higher than the national benchmarks, that's 93%, as well as the overall appearance of community much higher than the benchmarks, and that puts us at seventh nationally. Utilities. Over three-quarters of respondents rated the overall quality of utility infrastructure as excellent or good, 77%. That is similar to other areas. Other facets that rated higher than national benchmarks included affordable high-speed internet access, the power utility, and utility billing. We will note that this was taken in fall of 2022 and was not conducted during Christmas. It's possible that that ranking may have been different if taken at that time. Timing is everything. Under safety. Franklin respondents continue to rank their overall feeling of safety terribly highly, 95% positive as excellent or good. And their feeling, that's the same as it was in 2019. The feeling of safety in your neighborhood during the daytime and downtown was even higher than that. 99% of respondents rated it as excellent or good, the feeling of safety they had in downtown and the feeling that they had of safety in their neighborhoods. No provision of public safety services did respondents rank below 84%. So that is anything where it comes to crime prevention, fire prevention, investigations, emergency preparedness across the board. All of that was rated very, very highly. In fact, it's probably our top rated overarching facet. For the natural environment, 8 of 10 respondents rated the overall quality as excellent or good, 83%. Of note, the cleanliness of the city of Franklin was rated as higher than national benchmarks. 9 out of 10 respondents rated the overall quality of the parks and recreational opportunities as excellent or good, and that also was similar to national benchmarks. Health and wellness, something that we certainly took interest in. This, one other point that should be made, this was the first survey that was taken post-COVID. We took our last survey in the fall of 2019, and 2.5 years later, we conducted this survey. So it's mindful to keep in mind these responses, given all that we have gone through in all of these areas over the last 2.5 years. 84% of respondents rated the overall health and wellness opportunities that they could seek in Franklin as excellent or good. That is higher than ratings seen in other cities. The availability of preventive health services and the quality of those services were rated higher than national benchmarks. However, it's important to note the drop in the availability of quality, affordable mental health care services. In 2019, respondents rated it as 2/3 positive, 67% excellent or good. That fell to 51% positive, excellent or good, in 2022.
So I think you think about this as a perception question, too. So I don't think there are fewer mental health services than there was 3 years ago. I think there's an awareness of the need and the gap that exists. And Mayor's been a strong advocate of that in the Find Hope Franklin efforts. It's something we see in the public safety realm with calls for service and the escalation of really mental health crisis type of calls that we see. And so this is really reflective of that. And Michael's point about the post-COVID realm, I think that has drawn some awareness around that maybe we did not have previously. But it is definitely something that is a community need. The city is part of that, but that is a broader community element that I think we all need to be aware of and think about how we get the help that is needed, make folks aware that it's okay to not be okay and to ask for that help, and that there are people out there to help you, and make sure we've got that readily available for folks.
It's always okay to talk about mental health. Final two facets, education, arts, and culture. 83% respondents rated the overall opportunities for education, culture, and the arts as excellent or good, and those rankings were generally higher than other cities. We ranked higher than national benchmarks in opportunities to attend cultural, arts, and music activities, community support for the arts, K-12 education, and opportunities to attend special events and festivals. And the final community livability facet is inclusivity and engagement. 3 out of 4 respondents rated their connection and engagement as positive, at 75%. Franklin residents remained very strong in their belief that the city is one of the best places in America to raise a child. 96% rated Franklin, Tennessee as a place to raise a child as positive, excellent or good. Oops. We also were rated higher by respondents as a place to retire, the sense of community, the sense of civic pride, the neighborliness of our residents, and opportunities to participate in social events, activities, volunteering, and ability to participate in community matters, forums and functions such as this that you're participating in right now. So let's shift gears for a second to the unique questions which we ask this survey. So everything that you've seen already are questions which are asked as part of the standard survey tool, and that anyone that utilizes this tool, there's about 4 pages of questions that are unchanged. Anybody that uses it answers those questions, same questions, same way, anywhere in America. But we do customize it because we have a strategic plan, Franklin Forward. We've had it now for about 10 years. And there are certain questions that we need to ask in order to get answers for that plan. the most important, arguably, and certainly one that is on the people's minds a lot of the time, is please rate your level of satisfaction with the City of Franklin's management of growth. 76% rated their satisfaction of the city's management of growth as either very or somewhat satisfied. So 76% positive. Our benchmark, however, is 80%. And it was 80% in 2019, and it was 84% positive in 2016. So this is below the benchmark that we set for ourselves. It is important to note, however, that even though it's below the benchmark, number one, it's very, very much on people's minds. And so as we get to the open-ended responses in a second, you'll see that 31%, nearly one in every three people who were asked, you know, what is the major issue facing Franklin, Tennessee, they said growth or management of growth as that top concern. And the second is, because you can slice this and we can see very satisfied, somewhat dissatisfied, very dissatisfied, we can see that the number of people who felt very dissatisfied regarding the management of growth has actually not changed since 2019. That's 7% of overall respondents. So again, the sort of area of drop comes in the middle, the sort of somewhat satisfieds or somewhat dissatisfieds. The second non-standard question we asked was, please rate how important, if at all, you think it is for the city to enhance each of the following services or amenities. And we gave respondents five choices: regional transit, affordable workforce housing, greenway connectivity, retail entertainment options, and public art. The largest interest in affordable workforce housing had 73% of respondents saying that it was essential or very important for the city to enhance the service. Regional transit and greenway connectivity were next at 61% in both, followed by retail and entertainment options, and then public art is the lowest.
So just, that's a hard chart to read. So Michael hit on some of them, but it is interesting to look at in terms of folks who said essential or very important in terms of these broader categories. The highest was affordable and workforce housing, combined at 73%, saying essential or very important. Then you had regional transit and greenway connectivity, so transportation-related elements at 61%. Retail and entertainment options, 52%, said essential or very important. And then public art was at 35%, who identified that as essential or very important. So it just gives you a sense of, when we ask people how important are each of these to you, that's how they weighed in.
The final question asked was on the open, was the open-ended question. One of the most interesting, and I think for all of us, quite honestly, the most interesting set of results we get are the open-ended responses. These are presented, they are available to you online. I think there's about 13 or 14 pages. They are taken absolutely verbatim. The only thing that we did was to add page numbers to make sure that you could easily flip through them, but otherwise they are completely unedited and span the gamut of human thought. Which is exactly what you would hope for in your community. The question that we have asked now for three consecutive surveys is, aside from transportation or traffic-related issues, what is the most important challenge or problem facing Franklin today? 31% said that managing growth and development was the most important, followed by affordable housing at 22%, and yes, followed by infrastructure and roads at 11%. That is pretty consistent, that at least 10% of survey respondents still say that traffic or transportation or roads is the most important, even though we say, aside from that, what is the most important? But it is important, if you look at the cost of livability, affordable housing, and management of growth, 64% in those three categories said that growth, housing, and transportation accounted as their lead concerns. So again, not terribly surprising. This is consistent with previous years. The numbers, however, as we'll see here in a second, have increased in some of these areas with concern.
Yeah, Eric? The thing on this one that jumped out at me is I really blended the affordable housing at 22% and the cost of living affordability, which is a little broader, but I think they're brother and sister. I mean, they are related big time. So when you blend those together, you're at 32%. And that is a significant increase in that area identified by our respondents than we've seen previously. And the next slide is going to bring that home even further, but that really jumps out at you.
So one of the ways that you can present information, present data, especially in an open-ended survey, is to do a word cloud. This is the top 50 words that appeared in the open-ended responses. And obviously, y'all are familiar with word clouds. The more frequent the word is mentioned, the bigger the word is. So in this case, housing, Franklin, growth, affordable were mentioned more than any other four words, followed by infrastructure and city, and then people, community, development, population, on down. You can do this in any number. I mean, you can do 10, you can do 50, you can do 100. We thought that for this purpose, the top 50, because it obviously doesn't change the largest ones. And it's just a good way visually to see how frequent it really kind of ties back to these percentages in terms of the comments and how frequent they were. So let's compare ourselves to ourselves. This chart shows the 2012 to 2016 to 2019 to 2022 responses in four major questions. The first is, how would you describe the overall quality of life in Franklin, Tennessee? And as we mentioned on this, we are wonderfully consistent and wonderfully positive. In 2012, it was 94%, and in the last three surveys, it has been 97%. The next line down, which is a little harder to see, either in green or black print, is sort of the national benchmark and percentile. And you can see that we've been higher or much higher. We rank in the 98th percentile. Currently with response to that in the 2022 survey. The next question, are things in the city of Franklin moving in the right direction? This has been up and down over time. 82% rated positively in 2012. That dropped to 73% in 2016. It rose to 75% in 2019. And in 2022, it fell to 66%. Now, that's still two out of every three saying yes, but it certainly is lower, similar to other communities and where folks elsewhere in America believe that direction, that their city is moving in the right direction. How would you rate the job being done or the quality of services provided by city government? This has remained relatively stable in the last 10 years. But you can see that it has dropped from where we were at the end of last decade. So 83% positive in 2012, 89% positive in 2016, 93% positive in 2019, but then dropping to 82% positive in 2022. This question is asked immediately by the next question on the survey device, which is, how would you rate the job being done and the quality of services provided by the federal government? We did not ask this question in 2012, but we did starting in 2016. 44% rated it as positive in 2016. That rose to 53% in 2019, and it fell down to 37% in 2022. That also is comparable to other cities that respond. Our next comparable. Ladies and gentlemen, there are two things which are constants in life. They are death and taxes. So let's talk taxes for a second. The surveys have asked, obviously, the same question in the last three, but something comparable in 2012. So in 2012, the survey asked, for the services that you receive, would you say that property taxes in Franklin are too high, just about right, or too low? And you can see that in 2012, 69% said that it was just about right. 20% too high, 5% too low, and 6% in 2012 said, I don't know. The last three surveys, we've asked a slightly different version of that question, and that is, please rate the following categories of Franklin government for their performance, and that is the value of services to the taxes paid. In 2016 and 2019, these pie charts were 76% positive. So in 2019, 53% good and 23% excellent, with 20% fair and 4% poor. In 2019, it stayed 76% positive, but the pie shifted somewhat. So more people thought that the service, the value was better. So 26% said excellent, and 50% said good, and 20% said fair, and again, 4% said poor. In 2022, that dropped to 72%, so 4% drop in positivity. 40%, or 42% good, excuse me, but 30% excellent. So in this chart in particular, we see that the sort of edges, those people that feel like they're really not getting value or rank it poor, has increased by 3% from 4 to 7%. But the people who really feel that their service, the taxes they're paying for the services they're getting is really good, the excellent, has increased to 30%. And again, it's the edges, the sort of the overall good where that's collapsing. All right, hydration break. The next set of comparables we're going to look at are just three areas where we rank excellent. So this is just the top, if you will. So very satisfied, excellent in terms of the services that are provided. Neighborliness has always been strong for us. As you can see in 2012, 20% of all respondents said that they felt that the neighborliness of Franklin residents was excellent. That increased to 27% in 2016, to 32% in 2019, and is now at 36%. So over one-third of all respondents say that their neighbors are actually very neighborly, and that they really like their neighborhoods and like living and interacting in their neighborhoods. Economic opportunity and jobs. 8% rated it as excellent in 2012. It's almost doubled in each of the last three surveys to 19% rated excellent in 2016, 37% rated it as excellent in 2019, and 46%, or nearly one out of every two respondents, rate the overall economic opportunity and the ability to access jobs in Franklin's community as extremely positive. And then finally, shopping. This was 8% excellent in 2012, 50% excellent in 2016, 58% excellent in 2019, but then dropped back to only one out of every two people feeling that their shopping opportunities were excellent in Franklin, Tennessee in 2022. But for the good, there is the not so good. This is the percent of Franklin residents rating the following issues as poor. Cost of living. 15% rated it as poor in 2012, 20% in 2016 and 2019, and that's increased to 29% in 2022. Affordable housing has seen the greatest rate of increase of any of these. 11% rated affordable housing as poor in 2012, 35% in 2016, 42% in 2019, and now 58% in 2022. Transportation and traffic has generally been one of those areas where we rate lower. This chart, however, will say that the people that rate it as poor has actually gone down. 16% rated it as poor in 2012, 29% in 2016, but only 23% rating it as poor in 2019, and 22% rating it as poor in 2022. And finally, the level of diversity. 8% in 2012, 9% poor in 2019, 10% poor in 2019, and up to one out of every four, 25% rating it as poor in 2022. So one of the other ways to look at it is looking at the last 5 years of respondents across the 600 communities that utilize this survey is where do we rank? So this next set of slides, and it's our final set of graphical slides before we wrap up, is going to take a look at our comps. So nationally, how do we compare both top 10 as well as below 200th? And then finally, areas where we rank very, very positively for cities of our size, 50 to 100,000. So notable national benchmark comparisons include the city of Franklin ranks second nationally when it comes to the vibrancy of our downtown commercial area, overall quality of business and service establishments, employment opportunities, and opportunities to participate in religious or spiritual events and activities. Third nationally in economic development and preservation of the historical and cultural character of our community. Fourth nationally in sense of civic or community pride. Fifth nationally as a place to work, the variety of business or service establishments, and again, the neighborliness of residents. Sixth, in overall image and reputation. Seventh, in overall quality of life, sense of community, a place to raise a child, opportunities to attend special events and festivals, and overall appearance. Eighth, nationally, in connection and engagement to their community. And 10th nationally in overall economic health. So all very, very positives, very positive trends. These have remained consistent from 2016 to 2019 and once again in 2022. But again, for the good, there's the not so good. This chart shows where we rank below 200th and the percentile. Our worst rank is 282nd. And that comes in for the availability of affordable, quality housing. 245th for ease of travel by bicycle and the use of public transportation, and if you've used public transportation instead of driving. This is one that confuses us, because the metrics themselves and the responses don't look that bad in 2016 and 2019, but we ranked 242nd for the quality of recycling services. This may be one of our thoughts is keep in mind that if you live in your home, you get recycling services from the city of Franklin. But if you are a commercial business owner or you live in an apartment and you may have a commercial hauler, you may not have access to ease of recycling. That's one of the possibilities here that puts that metric there. 236th for traffic flow on major streets. Brother and sister to the top one, as Eric said, cost of living, 224th. Ease of travel by car, 212th. Overall health and wellness opportunities, 209th. And again, the variety of housing options, 202nd. So finally, where do we stand with cities of our size, comparably? We rank first in the nation for mid-sized cities as a place to work, connection and engagement in the community, the safety of the downtown during the day, the overall quality of business and service establishments, the vibrancy of our downtown, the preservation of historic or cultural character of the community, our sense of civic pride, our neighborliness, our opportunities to participate in social events and attend special events and festivals, the value of services for the taxes we pay, the importance on focusing on the overall quality of the transportation system, and we rank first nationally for cities of our size in overall personal health. Mr. Stuckey.
All right, so this is where we move forward with this. Okay. So we've presented it to you today. We're actually presenting this to the board tomorrow. It's been deferred three times in a row with various other scheduling conflicts and time constraints. So we'll present it to the board from there. It's something we're already shared with our leadership team, and they are processing it. It's something we want to integrate, not just in the upcoming budget, but beyond that. So we'll continue to work on that. We put it on our website. There are elements in our strategic plan and our various performance measures that tie directly to what we hear in this citizen survey. So you'll see all that processed. We are in the process of updating our strategic plan. This will be a key element that'll feed into that is what did we hear from our citizens? What's important? What's on their mind? And how does that affect what we put our focus on as we update that strategic plan? So those are the kind of the key elements that come to it.
I think as we look at it, there's a whole lot of positives. There are things that have slipped over time. We're wondering how to interpret those. The participation level in this survey, the strange drop in that is interesting in terms of having, you know, being above the average pretty consistently and then having a rate that's pretty significantly below the average in terms of response percentage. I don't know what to do with that. The timing of the survey was a little later in the year. Don't know if people were distracted or what that might be, or they just didn't choose to engage as much. And that's true of both the random selected group and the what we call the all-comers, where we just open the same survey up to everybody to take it. And we used all the same efforts to promote it throughout the process. So that's just interesting. I don't know if that leads you to some of that slippage because you have people who just had something they really needed to share with us that drove them to participate, and others who may not have been as passionate just didn't give us that feedback. I don't know. But it's something for us to process and something for us to be mindful of, because we want that feedback. We want to use that feedback to help us move forward. So this is an ongoing effort. We'll look to do this in another couple years as we continue to track feedback from our citizens and see what things we can move the needle on as we continue to work to serve this great community. So I'll stop there. I don't know, Mindy, how much time we have, if there's any other reflections or questions we can offer you.
We can have time for one or two questions. Oh, Mayor? Or can I go to Ed in the back? Yeah. Ed, just say it and I'll repeat it. How about that?
One of the things that was presented was on the transportation side, the satisfaction actually improved. Is there anything in the survey that gives you guidance into why people think it has improved? And are those duplicable so it can improve even more? Or is it things like finishing Mac Hatcher that's a one-shot deal?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What guidance is there to keep that number going up?
So Ed was saying there's an improvement in transportation satisfaction, and can we tie it to one thing, or is it completion of some major projects? Eric, any thought?
Yeah, and Michael may have some insights. There's nothing that jumps out at me from comments. Sometimes comments, you can kind of piece those together with the direct responses. My instinct is a little bit what you touched on, as we saw a major project completed in the Mac Hatcher connection, and we have some other significant roadway projects in the last 3 years that have either been completed or are in process. So that gives you a sense of something is happening to help address it, at least locally. So I think we get some credit on that, but I think it's more seeing some projects come through is the best thing I can tell you, and we continue to focus on trying to deliver projects as best we can too. So, and some of that's us, some of that's Tennessee Department of Transportation, and those elements as well. I don't know, Michael, anything else?
No is the short answer, because all of these questions, the open-ended, you can get some insight if somebody volunteers it. But otherwise, you're just getting data, and you're getting comparable data from Survey A to Survey B. There's bias in every survey, depending upon how the question is asked. And the reason we use this particular tool is because the bias remains constant because the question is being asked the same way. So we draw, you know, a positive from the fact that the people that are ranking transportation and traffic and getting around Franklin as really bad is going down. That does not necessarily correlate into everybody thinks that getting around Franklin is the easiest thing in the world to do. So there's always a little bit of chicken and egg thinking through what are the motivations of people and how they're answering some of these questions, which you really will never be able to know unless, of course, we choose to do targeted follow-up surveys and, of course, acquire anecdotal information through certainly conversations that citizens have with their board members and all of you in events such as this.
Completely randomly, I did get the postcard and the mailing, and I did complete the survey, so I'm among that 14%, so glad to do that. Any other questions, Teresa?
So, you talk about the number of people who responded was lower this year, and I'm just wondering, and you may have already done all of this, but as people are getting, people who are younger than me are choosing to communicate in very different ways. And are we taking that into consideration when we issue a survey? Instead of doing hard copy mail, are we reaching out in more social ways that would draw those participants in?
So were there options for people who, so they could reply to the survey if they received the postcard or notification? I'll let you answer that.
We did the old-fashioned way with postcards and those kind of things, but we did work to promote it on our social media platforms and all those kind of elements. But that's something, I think, to continue to be in dialogue with the provider, because everybody's dealing with those changes and how people communicate. And, you know, I don't know. I can't get a handle on exactly why, but something's different. Time of year might have had something to do with it, but the changing landscape of how people communicate and connect has got to be part of the story too. So that's something we'll continue to think on and how we provide those opportunities.
You know, in 2016, we did this in early fall. In 2019, we did it in spring. In 2022, we did it in late fall. This was a survey that was conducted, from October through early December, right in the middle of the midterms, right as you're trying to do Halloween and Thanksgiving and into the Christmas season. So certainly, you know, it those things are things we're going to keep in mind from a timing perspective. But timing also matters in terms of how some of these results are. For example, snow plowing, positive, was ranked 57% in 2016, 71% in 2019, and then back down to 57% in 2022. Now, people may be thinking more about that when it's colder than if it's 80 degrees.
And just to clarify, most of these were done online. I mean, they had the option to do the old-fashioned printed, and we send that to them, I think, second or third iteration, we send a printed version in case that's somebody's preference. But it is largely an online platform, both those randomly selected and those who choose to do it on their own. We saw a drop on the self-selected folks who did it as well. I don't know why that is either, because we promoted it the same way. So it's a bit of a mystery, honestly.
One final question, Dr. Mike. You, Richard.
One major factor between 2019 and 2022 was the pandemic.
Absolutely.
And from a medical standpoint, that clearly brought out the deficiencies in mental health availability. Mm-hmm. That is primarily because it isn't covered by a lot of insurance companies.
Right.
Very difficult to get private insurance to allow patients to get reimbursed some mental health. And it's fairly deficient in government programs as well. So I think the isolationism of the pandemic unmasked the severe deficit in mental health services. I'm not sure that's being addressed very well. A lot of distractions now at the federal level, which probably explains the abysmal popularity of the federal government, which probably ranks up to popularity of
John Kennedy
mentioned recently.
Well, we certainly know the pandemic is working, is part of all of these changes in perceptions or how people think in a number of things. And it would really be interesting to see the next year of surveys of communities across the country, because part of what Michael showed you on those comparatives is our number may have dropped, but our percentile not that much different compared to the other communities. Maybe a little bit of drop or about the same in some of those situations. So it's like, are we all experiencing a similar shift or slide in certain perceptions? And I think that'd be even more interesting to see another year of that from other communities.
Your internet seems to have a satisfactory radio survey, but I don't believe that's the same in the county.
Yeah, this is city residents, yes.
In county south of Williamson County. But it seems that a lot of people are much happier working on home computer than they are face-to-face in the office.
For some, yes.
Thank you so much. I'm going to go through a quick couple slides. I do want to point out on your chair today, you have a card that gives you the rest of our dates of events in April, and there's a QR code on there you can scan to register for either QPR training, which is this Wednesday, At Franklin City Hall, 9:30 to 10:45 or so. It's free. There's a brochure out there on the table to tell you a little bit more about QPR. We do ask you register in advance for that. It is question, persuade, and refer suicide prevention training that Franklin tomorrow is coordinating in partnership with Find Hope Franklin. And then our Breakfast with the Mayors is April 25th. And that will have Franklin Mayor Ken Moore and Williams County Mayor Rogers Anderson. And we would encourage you to be there for that at Rolling Hills on April 25th. But the QR code will take you to the sign up for both of those free events. We also would encourage you just to stay engaged and share this program with others. And those events there. We also, on the back of this, are participating with a group to try and erect a piece of public art in our community, the Coach Jimmy Gentry and the Lost Heroes statue. It would be at the corner of Fifth Avenue, right there at Five Points, and he would be sitting on a bench looking towards the Veterans Memorial, looking for his friends who maybe didn't come home. And we are working with the sculptor Scott Wise, who just had his sculpture of Pekka Rinne unveiled in front of Bridgestone Arena. So he's doing this statue. It's going to be a great piece of art. And we're very close to finishing this project as well. And then follow us on social media. And just to that point, Eric mentioned briefly, if you should have been receiving over the last few months, if you attend Frank Talks regularly or register, we're doing a new program called On Second Thought, which allows us to delve deeper into some of the topics we've discussed today. It's a Zoom-only event. It's open only to those people who attend or register for Frank Talks. It is a meeting, so you are able to ask questions. And Eric and Michael have agreed to be with us on April 17th from 1:30 to 2:30. On April 17th, we'll have a Zoom meeting, and that link will be emailed out to you this week. If you want to participate, you just have to register in advance through Eventbrite, and then Eventbrite will give you the Zoom link for that program. So it's a new way of just getting a little more top information on these topics, because we know you'll go away and you may have a question that comes up, jot it down, and that's why we're doing On Second Thought. So we really encourage you to stay engaged. Your phone may be buzzing today. There's been another mass shooting in Louisville, Kentucky this morning. And just let's be a great neighbors and good friends to each other as we move forward. But look at these events, and hopefully we'll see you soon, maybe at Breakfast with the Mayors, if not next Monday on Zoom. Thanks so much. Have a great day.